meters. People think I be Johnny just come. Like I just got rich, like my money just come. Send them back to where they come from. For talking like the product of a torn condom. Southside me come from, me no care, my brother. One side, sit down for one chair, my brother. Come try, me will make you disappear, my brother. Long time it takes to reach here, my brother. Kilometers. I don't come kilometers. I don't walk that many kilometers. I'm from the teacher. I don't take for the game, she no pitas. I decide bad mind from a distance. Not this sweet, I be all on my pitas.
Thank you for such an empowering opening session. Please welcome the moderator of our next session, Embracing an Intergenerational Workforce, ACID's Vice President of Strategic Engagements, Jai Vargas.
Oye, me dio una fiebre el otro día por causa de tu amor, Cristiana.
Welcome, welcome. Bienvenidos, bienvenides, right? How is everyone? Welcome back in the room. How was your cafecito this morning? And how was Monica? Wasn't she incredible? She is like the burst of sunshine and energy that we all needed this morning, because I saw some of you were out last night. Not me. I just heard that you were out last night. I'm so glad that you're all here with us today. This is going to be an engaging conversation on embracing the intergenerational workforce. This conversation that we're having today is touching and focusing upon the fact that for the first time ever, we actually have five generations working with us. I'm going to read you those five generations just so that you're aware of the brackets of age that we're talking about. And also, when you think of a workplace meeting, you're probably thinking or envisioning perhaps a crowd that looks like this or one that's very similar at work. It always depends, of course, per industry, but they say that we now have 17-year-olds working with 75-year-olds that have yet to retire, perhaps because they don't want to, they love working, or perhaps because they can't. And so this conversation is going to be one where our colleagues, your colleagues from Toyota Motor North America, JP Morgan Chase, and Best Buy, yes, make some noise for them. I know that they have tons of support in the crowd because you guys came in droves, and I love that support. But they're going to talk to us about some of the programs and services and really intentional ways that they make sure that a brand new 17-year-old who's just starting their internship at your corporation, they know how to communicate and how to work well and how to find common ground with someone who's 75 years old that you may not notice, right? Someone who has so much information, data, and insights to be able to share. We're going to talk about mentorship programs, of course, but also reverse mentoring, making sure that both generations in conversation are helping each other learn something new. I want to share with you the categories just so that you have them in mind, because this is what we're going to be talking about today. So we have first the traditionalist generation. This generation is also known as the silent generation. This group was born between 1928 and 1945 during the Great Depression and World War II. And although the youngest members are in their late 70s, they're steadily growing in the workforce as fewer are able to retire. Then we have baby boomers. Baby boomers have been born between 1946 and 1964. Many of those baby boomers have actually retired during the pandemic. and continue to free up some jobs for younger generations. On average, boomers held 12 jobs over their lifetime, only half of which were after the age of 24. And then comes Gen X. Do we have any Gen Xers here? That is, perhaps you don't know, between 1965 and 1980. Now, do we have any Gen Xers here? Yes! Oh, I love that. They were called the latchkey kids during childhood and are known for their independence. They grew up in a time where a lot of women were now entering the workforce. And so they had to be home alone or at latchkey waiting for both parents to come back home. And then the next generation is millennials, or also known as Generation Y, born between 1981 and 1996. Do we have any millennials in the room? Yes! Oh my God, that's me. Oh my gosh. I am the oldest millennial. I'm 40 years old, but still cute. Millennials sit on both sides of the technological shift. They were born between before the population of the internet and personal computers, the Great Recession, a tough job market, and high student loans defined many millennials' entrance to the program. And the very last one we're going to talk about is Gen Z. Gen Z spans from being born between 1997 and 2012. Do we have any Gen Zs in the room? Oh my gosh, yay, I love that. After Gen Z actually comes another one, the sixth one. That's not the one we're going to talk about today. But that is anyone being born between 2010 and 2024. So that's Generation Alpha that's coming next after Gen Z. And then after that, they're going to be known as Generation Beta. So many different names. But I'd love to welcome to the stage some of your colleagues that are going to help us have this conversation. The first person I'm going to introduce is Sebastián Ontiveros. He is the National Director of Multicultural Business Alliance and Strategy at Group Toyota Motor North America. Please, a round of applause for Sebastián. Sebastián is responsible for developing and implementing strategies to enhance awareness of the Toyota and Lexus brands amongst diverse consumer groups across Toyota Motor North America. Thank you for being here. Who's here from Toyota? Yes, there they are. Love that. Thank you so, so much. Next up is Kristen Coleman. She is the DE&I Director, Head of Employee Engagement for Advancing Hispanics and Latinos at JP Morgan Chase. Kristen, welcome to the stage. She loves it. She loves it. I told you I'd get you some good music. Okay. Kristen is responsible for the employee careers and skills strategy and development programming to support increasing representation for Hispanics and Latinos globally at all levels of the firm, especially executive pipeline. Who is here from JP Morgan Chase? I love that. Thank you for being here. And last but not least, a dear friend, Jose, also known as Easy Gonzalez. He is the Associate Vice President at Best Buy. Where's Best Buy? Yes! Oh my goodness, I need a new TV. Jose, also known as Easy, is a native born of Guadalajara, Jalisco, Mexico. Who's from there? I love that. Jose, welcome to the stage. With majority of his lifetime in East Los Angeles, he is bilingual, English and Spanish, his first native language being Spanish, of course. He's part of the LGBTQ+ community and still learning, as it has been a bit of a challenging personal lifetime story. Jose, Easy, and I got to meet on a webinar a couple of years ago, and he just has such a beautiful story and such an incredible light to him, as well as Kristen and Sebastián. Welcome our panelists, aren't they great? I love it. Fantastic. Thank you. This is gonna be an awesome conversation. I said, we're gonna talk about the programs and strategies that you've all very intentionally made sure that your organizations, Toyota, JP Morgan, and Best Buy, have really dug deep into to make sure that everyone belongs. And so my first question is actually for you, Jose. How do the work values and expectations of traditionalists, the much older generation, how do those differ from the much younger generation now, Gen Z, in the workplace? And how can organizations bridge this gap effectively?
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, cool. I think that's a loaded question. Mm-hmm. I think it's complex, but it's even more complex if we don't know where to start. And so when you think about your personal experience or your formative years growing up, there, like, although it's unique to everyone, there are values that begin in your formative years growing up, based on what you were exposed to, based on what was going on in the world, based on technology, based on culture, traditions, and beyond. And so there isn't a one-size-fits-all approach. A recommendation before we start putting things into practice would be to get familiar and get to know your employees' experience, because there's a lot of misconceptions and stereotypes out there. You know, retail, I was reading an article, Retail Drive published an article around leading a multi-generational workforce, sharing that baby boomers invented the term workaholic, and that millennials and Gen Z work well or better with tech compared to baby boomers, traditionalists, and Gen X. And although statistically, yes, Gen Z and millennials grew up around more tech, I disagree that traditionalists, baby boomers, and Gen X don't work well with tech. Mm-hmm. You know, Dr. Santor, who wrote a book recently called Working with Gen Z, shared that regardless of the generation, 60% of the workforce reported a lack of training and development on the job, and that 98% of Gen Z reported lack of clear expectations on the job. So it's not inability, it's training and development where the opportunity is. And so when you zoom out and you think about the different ways that people learn, some people learn by reading, some people learn by listening, some people learn by viewing, some people learn by hands-on. So the ongoing challenge is how inclusive and progressive are the training and development programs. So I'll leave, in recapping what was just shared, since we're talking about generations, I'll leave you with, because I love acronyms. It's not an acronym that Best Buy uses, but it's an acronym that came to mind. GEN for Gen. G, get to know your employees' experience. E, exclude any stereotypes. And N, nurture inclusive and progressive training and development programs.
I love that. And I saw someone clapping. You can clap for that. I love that. GEN. Beautiful. We're going to make sure to quote that once you're tweeting to get that prize. My next question is for Kristen. Can you share some examples of successful initiatives and programs that JPMorgan Chase has launched, has completed, that encourages intergenerational mentorship as well as knowledge transfer between the older generation and the younger generation?
Yeah, so a couple things. You stole my line. I'm the oldest millennial with you, so fabulous. And thank you so much for having us here today. I'm proud of the fact that Advancing Hispanics and Latinos is here really to close the gap. So when I think about the programs that we're offering, it is really making sure that we're changing the composition of the workforce. So when I think about some of the cool programs for the last 2 years, that's how long our office has been here. And so we've had things like our Advancing Hispanics and Latinos Fellowship Program for college sophomores. And so it's a way to look at corporate America, get a preview before you're even an intern, and really get insights from senior Latino leaders, right? So how many of us were the first where we didn't have a path before us, or we didn't have an executive to impart that knowledge? So it's a way for those young aspiring talents to really get a leg up, right? What are the unwritten rules of being a Latino in corporate America, and how do I achieve different goals and aspirations and not do it the hard way? I did it the hard way. So I think a lot of us didn't have those programs before. So, that's certainly one of them. And then as we think about once you're here and making sure that as we think about the disproportionality of Latino representation, right? And we think about, you know, Gen Z being 25% Latino, we really have to invest in that space. So I'm proud of the fact that we have culturally relevant programs and mentorship opportunities that really connect Latino talent at all levels of the organization with senior leaders, right? Whether it's small group circles where you're, you know, sitting with people in departments that are not your own and getting mentorship and career guidance from senior leaders. So those are just a couple of them that I'm really proud of. And I think that the culturally relevant training is paramount to that. It's not just the connections, but it's how do we break down, you know, the inherent parts of our being that are telling us that, you know, my cultural values are conflicted with my corporate values and what I hear about self-advocacy and different things. So we really just try to blow that up and really create a space for conversations so that Latinos can really, you know, take charge to change that makeup and really kind of, you know, get an accelerated view of where they can be and have that role model to learn from and really think about the reverse mentorship too, right? Because for a lot of it's really thinking about as the workforce changes, what are the things that we have to help some of those older leaders demystify around, you know, what our values are and how we need to kind of show up in the workplace. So we've got a ton that really reach employees and meet them where they are, right? Because everyone's at a different part of their journey. And so those are some of the things that I'm personally really proud of that we're launching to just make sure that we offer a suite of programs that employees can be successful at the end of the day.
I love that. Thank you so much for that. I want you to elaborate a little bit more on the program where I had an opportunity to sit with the fellows and I taught them a little bit about authenticity and branding. How many were in that cohort?
Yeah, so we had almost 400. So this is the second summer that we had essentially a total of 400 students. And I think what's really beautiful about it is in the DEI organization, it's Black and Hispanic students. So a lot of them were Afro-Latino. And so one of my favorite things about it is really, you know, not only bringing leaders to kind of support them in their journey, but also making sure that we are thinking about the intersectionality and multiplicity of backgrounds and experiences that are represented by the Latino culture. Mm-hmm. So, you know, again, I think that the fact that over the last two summers, we've reached 400 Latino students from over 100 colleges and universities, and not just the Ivy League, right? Like, we're going and reaching them where they are, Hispanic-serving institutions in different places. So those are some things that are big wins that we're going to continue to grow and mature just so that we can, you know, really increase that representation. Because one thing that we're finding out is that the availability of Latinos out in the marketplace is significantly higher than we're seeing come in the door. So it's really around, you know, how can we create a space for Latinos that they can see themselves here and also demystify. I tell people that JPMorgan Chase is a dinosaur, right? We're 200 years old. So part of it is making sure that whether it's understanding that we are an organization of 300,000 that's more than just the brick and mortar four walls that you see. It's, you know, we're a tech company and we're all these other things that, you know, we have to reshape the narrative of who we are so that we can get more people to see themselves belong here.
I love that. Thank you. So my next question is for Sebastian. What strategies can leaders employ to leverage the experience and knowledge of baby boomers while also accommodating the preferences of younger generations like Gen Z in the workplace?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sid. Thank you, Hased, for having us here today. I was told that I was going to walk out to Bad Bunny, so I'm a little bit disappointed about that.
Maybe you'll walk out to Bad Bunny.
No, in full transparency, these are the strategies that have worked for me, right? These aren't necessarily Toyota sanctioned, but I also have an acronym. We like to think in threes, so I call it CCT. So collaboration, transparency, and collaboration, coordination, and transparency. And so what that means for me is making sure that our teams are kind of fully aware of what you're doing and where you're doing it, so that way you're able to build that trust. I think that's so important when you're dealing with intergenerational workforces and making sure that you're creating a space where everybody feels like they're bringing their full selves to work and that they can contribute to the team, no matter where they kind of fall in that generational spectrum. I haven't quite seen what Easy's talking about in terms of the discrepancy with some of our generational workforces. I do agree that one of the things that he hit on was the training and the opportunity that we have as companies and organizations to make sure that our teams are, we're meeting them where they are. I think that when we provide those tools and resources, we're really able to help bring people to the table and make sure that their abilities are shown in full force and that they're being valued as a team member. So that's one of the things that that I like to practice in my own team in particular.
Nice. And we know that Toyota has an incredible tradition and history of making sure that they are really very intentional about the skill sets and the characteristics and the experience of workers. And if perhaps they'd like to move into a different department, they give them that opportunity based on those skill sets or give them more training. So I know Toyota is like incredible at that.
Yeah, absolutely. We have, so in the Japanese language and Japanese culture, there's a concept and a word called Kaizen, and it's translated into continuous improvement. And so I think that when you come into an organization like Toyota, you are really able to kind of spread your wings, and they do provide you with the tools and resources to be successful and to pivot, to go explore. It's another Japanese term that we use, Ginchi Genbutsu, to go and figure out where you can add value to the company and where you can grow as an individual and as a professional. Can I ask real quick, who here in the crowd drives a Toyota? By a show of hands.
Wow.
All right. I just like to know where my people are at, but we can change this later. We can change this
employee
later.
Employee discount? Is that what you're offering?
Well, it's not Oprah, not you get a car, you don't. Something like that.
I love that. Thank you, Sebastian. Jose, tell us a little bit about some of the programs internally that Best Buy has for mentorship, reverse mentoring, something that you can share a little bit about what Best Buy does.
Yeah, and so, well, sure, the programs, and also I'd love to build on the previous topic.
Yes.
But from a program standpoint, at Best Buy, when we think about development and mentorship, it's centered around three things. It's expansion of network, it's skill development, and it's professional development plans. And there are a number of different ways and experiences where this shows up. Could be through employee resource groups, could be through workshops, could be through partnerships with organizations like I said, or even an employee having an opportunity to a quarterly conversation versus a one-year-end review type of conversation, where in addition to discussing team goals, there's a discussion around skill development and career progression. And skill development on two dimensions, functional skills and leadership or interpersonal skills. Mm-hmm. And functional skills, think system, software, things that are critical to an activity within the role, like Power BI, think Tableau, PowerPoint, Excel, et cetera. And then leadership skills, think adaptability, emotional intelligence, stakeholder management, relationships, et cetera. And so through those quarterly conversations, there's a commitment to feedback and development that progresses quarter over quarter. And so development and mentorship is integrated into the entire employee journey when we think about the experience.
Nice.
And then, so answers that question, and then if we have time.
Yes, for sure. I want to ask Kristen, how can organizations create a work environment that values diversity in age as much as it does in other aspects of diversity, such as gender or ethnicity? Because we see a lot of programs focused on the women in the workplace,
yeah,
right? How can we make sure that organizations are more intentional about the age difference and the programs?
So I think that with regard to kind of standing up departments like ours, I mean, I recognize that being able to do Latino things 24/7 is a unique part of a business.
It's amazing.
That not everybody
has. She
has
the best job at JP Morgan. Sorry, Jamie.
But I think when you think about creating these communities and a little bit of segmentation, it kind of draws a bigger conversation. And one thing that I'm proud of is that we do have a next-gen, you know, ERG that is really related to that. But what's beautiful about that is even though it was designed initially for early careers, we're finding that many generations are actually joining because they want to know the inverse of what are these different generations. You know, what are the things as a leader that I need to know? And in some cases, like myself, I was a leader young where I had individuals that I was managing much older than me. Mm-hmm. So I think that fostering these groups where you can have conversations and really DEI learning beyond just any one specific group is the starting point to really just make sure that you're creating those systems of practice. Mm-hmm. And again, I think that for us, we've created tools and resources and ways that if this was, you know, uncomfortable for you, we create a space where, you know, here is a, you know, DEI learning in a box related to, you know, talk about different things related to not only ethnic diversity, but different segments. So I think that for us, we just recognize that there's a deep desire for employees to get it right and really coming from a place of wanting to find common ground, find understanding and learning. And so I think the more the organizations understand, you know, we've seen this trajectory of organizations that they're learning organizations or HR, DEI, et cetera, are on this journey to like create more capacity to create inclusive leaders. So one of that is, you know, we're performance, you know, performance time, right? This is a perfect time. And I think that for a lot of organizations, if they're creating a measurement to see those actual outputs related to someone investing in DEI learning, we give you credit for that. We expect it. We expect all employees, whether you're managing people or not, to make that a part of your DNA. So I think that the more organizations can see the value in creating these either ERGs or departments or DEI learning toolkits for more places and spaces, just like you think about, you know, again, during COVID and during the times of George Floyd, organizations were trying to get proximate where, whether we're tackling anti-Semitism, whether we're talking about all these different things, we have to show up in a very intentional way to create more conversation, more dialogue, more learning. So I think that we're on this evolution to it being part of our just DNA and part of our business practices. Mm-hmm. And I think the more that we see that showing up in corporate America, the better off that we're going to be because, you know, again, we always say we want to work ourselves out of a job. I mean, I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon, but, you know, ideally it's that we start baking those into the way we do business. So. Mm-hmm.
And how long have you been at JP Morgan now? 20
years.
20 years.
So that was me back in the day, right? I was, you know, when I was a millennial, or I'm still a millennial technically, but when I was starting at 19 years old, it was me sitting in this place where it was just like not feeling like, you know, I could use my voice. And now that's completely changed. And now we're thirsty for all this innovative, new, fresh perspective. And I think that's beautiful to see that journey come along in that way in just a couple decades. I mean, it went really, really fast. But I think this is now where, you know, we're in a wonderful place where that is a requirement for businesses to, you know, show up in the right way for our customers and really, you know, to drive our business agenda at the end of the day. So it's a beautiful time to have all these generations really collaborating for, you know, the best of what we want to show up with for any industry that we're in.
Intentionally collaborating for innovation.
I think it's a beautiful time to be Latino as well.
Yeah.
I think just, if I could real quick,
yes,
building
please.
Upon that, I feel like this conversation is so timely and so fitting because while we're talking about intergenerational workforce, I think Latinos fit so uniquely into that conversation in terms of our ability to be that bridge to these five generations, right? I think that if you've ever translated documents for your parents, if you've ever, you know, had to be the translator for a conversation with your parents or anything of that nature, you've already done this work. You've already been kind of in this position of being able to manage up and manage down and kind of connect the dots between different generations and folks who may not have traditionally, you know, clear-cut objectives and clear-cut ideologies. So I think that that's kind of one of our superpowers right now in this workforce, is that you have an innate ability to lead during this time. So I really think this is an exciting discussion to have right now.
I love it. And speaking about the Latino and the Hispanic engagement, Toyota's
Todos, ERG, you still have the founders of Todos very much intentionally.
Call them the
working.
Godfathers.
Godfathers, I love that. Tell us a little bit more about how the ERG explores making sure that the ones that created and founded the ERG are still very much giving advice, but also involved.
Engaged, No, I think Todos in particular is just an incredible BPG. So I have responsibility for AAPI, Hispanic, LGBTQ+, and a few other multicultural segmentations. But Todos in particular is one of our oldest and one of our most well-represented ERGs, or we call them internally business partnering groups, or BPGs. And we just celebrated, actually, this past week, our second symposium in Michigan in our R&D location. So big shout-out to Todos and our leadership there, putting in the work to make sure that our folks are represented and that we're continuing to support them in their career journey. But I think it's important or kind of unique that we have some of our founders that are still there, still providing counsel, still providing direction and helping us kind of avoid landmines, if you will. Mm-hmm. And that's part of that work. That's part of that intergenerational collaboration that, that we get to see at Toyota. I think something that's also pretty special about Toyota is that we have a very long tenure, right? I think the average tenure at Toyota is something like 15 to 20 years. And so, you know, you're very much reminded until you hit that 10-year mark that you're kind of a babe. But I think that, that lends credence to the company and its ability to attract and keep talent. And Todos is just a great example of that. So, you know, having those intergenerational leaders collaborate with us on opportunities to engage this next generation of workforce through programs like the symposium and through collaboration with our other BPGs has been so impactful. Because you're not just Latino, you know, during Hispanic Heritage Month, you're Latino the other 360 days out of the year as well, right? So we make sure that we're connecting with, you know, doing joint collaborations with our Spectrum or LGBTQ BPG. We're doing it with our African American as well, just because to make sure that we're connecting all the dots to those intergenerational but also multicultural facets.
Absolutely, and Toyota does it so well. So if you all are out there thinking, how can we create some programs and systems more intentionally about how our generations, being as wide as a gap as it possibly can get with those five generations, definitely connect with Sebastian, Kristen, and Jose, because they have ERGs that are specifically focused around making sure that they are creating programs for all of these generations, right? It's usually called like the generations ERG, right? And so make sure that if that's an opportunity for you to create and lead an ERG based on intentional programs for all generations, that's an opportunity for a conversation to be able to say, how did you guys do that? What did you do first? What exactly is your mission, your goal, and what do you see being accomplished here? And for the most part, it's that reverse mentorship, right? That very intentional transfer of knowledge between those generations. My last question is going to be for you, Jose, to elaborate a little bit on what I asked Kristen earlier. Can you share some examples of successful initiatives or programs that have encouraged some intergenerational mentorship?
Yeah, first, before I forget, shout out to Best Buy and the Unidos ERG.
Yes.
I know they're in here.
They're here.
And I think, so I'll answer that, but I think I wanted to build on, like, a lot of times we find ourselves in a place like, where do we start? And I'll share this phenomenon, the power of 1 + 1 = 3. And I know you mathematicians out there, this is going to drive you crazy. But it's the science of the combination of talent and experiences that equal more than them separately. And that's how I like to think about diversity and talent. Because, you know, I was on this path where I was looking for a magic formula on how I would, you know, serve and solve for all. And there isn't a magic formula. I think what I did find, though, is that everyone's looking for a sense of connection and belonging. But belonging may mean different things to different people. And belonging's attributed to could be safety, could be inclusion, could be connection, could be community, could be autonomy. And so, you know, having the privilege of leading a multi-generational workforce, one of the things, in order to create that sense of belonging and that space where people feel safe, you need to start with psychological safety, where people feel safe to share their experience. So we can learn from those that have an abundance of experience, but also learn from those that challenge the status quo. And so what I do now, anytime I join a new team, I spend intentional work in creating psychological safety through a number of different exercises where people feel safe to share about their formative years, their life experience, things that are unique about them that a lot of people may not know, and that could be their superpower and unique skill sets. And I'm always blown away on how like interconnected teams become, because it brings down the barriers of us versus them. And so I would share that 1 + 1 = 3 is real, and it starts with psychological safety. Now, the last program that I would share, I actually had the opportunity to experience this and pilot this, where we actually post jobs that are temporary job assignments or special projects, 6 to 12 months. And an employee gets an opportunity to completely unplug from their current role and fully commit to a different role, a completely different team, a completely different business group with a different leader. And so this enables knowledge transfer, skills transfer, access to network mutually. So not only does the employee gain access to a network, but they gain knowledge, they gain skills, and the organization becomes more agile. So not only is it the right thing to do to enable talent mobility, is what we call it, but it enables an organization to be more agile. So
I love that. That's fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. Now we're going to switch to Q&A. If you have a question, make your way over to the microphones in the middle of the aisles. And we're also going to see if there are any virtual questions. I have a question right over here from my colleague, Wanda.
Don't be shy.
Okay, so our first question is from the virtual audience. Joshua Magana, lead data scientist at Target. How do you foster a culture of mentorship when you yourself have never been mentored yourself, both for yourself and others? Mm-hmm. And that's open to the panel.
Mm-hmm. So I would say in terms of mentorship, I don't know that I formally had a mentor growing up myself, but I think that the more I've been in the organizations, it's really about, you know, to your point, building connections, building rapport, asking questions, being curious. And I think that goes a long way in an organization, right? So I think it's really just starting with that. You know, again, I think that there's a lot of mentorship that you can give and provide peer-to-peer or, you know, regardless of levels. So I think that it's really just empowering yourself to, you know, assign value to what you can offer to another individual. And I think that that's where it begins. And then that's essentially going to allow you to, you know, continue to grow in your leadership skills and get noticed. So I think that people need to kind of get out of their own way. And I think that this is where, you know, we don't see enough Latinos, especially, you know, stepping up, like habla loud, like be there, show up. And so I think it really is just a matter of taking ownership of that value and starting is really the biggest thing in terms of mentorship. I think the rest will grow from there.
Fantastic. We have a question over here from Lisbeni. Hey, Lisbeni, travel and leisure.
Yes. Hi, everybody. My name is Lisbeni Durang. As Jai mentioned, I work with Travel and Leisure Co. based out of Orlando, Florida. And this conversation hits very close to home for me because not only am I on the board for our company's DRG called Fuerte, I'm also a learning and development manager. So this conversation really is sort of a cross-section of everything that I'm passionate about. So being that we're the parent company for Wyndham Resorts across the world, and there is a huge cohort of Latino associates, but a huge majority of them are in frontline roles, guest services, housekeeping, there's language barriers. So though we have a DRG that's been established, we're one of the smallest ones because those that we're trying to reach are not what we call computer users. They're not in the corporate world, they're not in these managerial roles all the time. They really are what we call frontline or field associates. So as we plan for 2024 for our DRG offerings, we lead sessions and development programs. What are some of your recommendations for how we can get these associates to sort of bridge that gap moving out of field work and into more corporate roles and beyond? I know, Easy, you mentioned that there seems to be a disconnect there as to what generations are aware of, operational versus leadership skills. So any recommendation as to what you think are the best skill sets that we could provide for these associates transitioning into or out of the field and into more corporate roles and beyond? And I'll be taking notes.
Yeah, I think I can share a point of view. You know, oftentimes our employees also, we don't know what we don't know, but leaders, we don't know what we don't know. And so I would start with spending intentional time in the field to get to know the employee experience in the field. Because oftentimes what could happen is there could be a corporate program that is structured not to serve the field employee. And so then there's a disconnect there on have we took the time to understand the experience in the field, so then we can build a program that actually supports that. Could be schedules. Sometimes the time zones are a thing. And so we want to be really intentional with how we structure the programs. And then you also want to have some type of local representation. Because sometimes if there is a deep sense of connection and belonging that employees are seeking for, then sometimes they don't want to hear it from somebody in corporate. They want to hear it from some of their leaders that they're closest to. So upskilling your local leaders is another way that you can help bridge that gap.
Yeah, if I could, I would just add, at Toyota, we have manufacturing plants throughout the country, and it's very similar, right? We have folks who are working on the line. You can't build, you can't pull people from the line when we're building cars. So building on what Easy said, absolutely. You want to make sure that you're empowering folks that are there on the ground. You also want to do some your own research, physically going there and seeing what it's like for those individual workers. And then help create some sort of, and this is just me trying to be a little bit more practical, but create some sort of toolkit to help create a chapter at these locations that you're trying to empower and hear more from and help them grow. So that would be my advice, just adding to what Easy said.
And the one thing that I would add is sometimes, depending on the organization, there's just a sea of information. So it's about making it easy and accessible. So, kind of going back to the sentiments of my panel's peers, whether it's scheduling, whether it's bite-sized learning, maybe you can't do a three-hour career development session because you're an hourly employee and you have, a 30-minute lunch. Maybe it's making those bite-sized career development or mentorship lunch and learns at a time or bite size so that you can meet people where they are. So I think these guys are right on point in terms of all those things, but it really is getting super proximate. So whether it's market, whether it's bite size versus how are we sharing options so that this is applicable and it's relevant to everyone that we want to reach? Because, again, I'd be the first one to say, coming from the human resources organization, the disproportionality of Latino representation is something I think about all the time, right, in terms of the composition. So it really is making sure that, we're creating solutions at all levels, but that we're listening, we're asking the questions, and if we haven't taken the time, we definitely have to start there. And it's really just for me, I started, as a part-time teller at JPMorgan Chase, so I get it, right? I started from the bottom, and I get every challenge that exists there. So it really is just making sure that whether it's a corporate leader that's leading that program or whether it's an ambassador, it's your ERG network. Lo siento, I forgot to give love to Adelante BRG at JPMorgan Chase. But those are the folks that you have to kind of create the army around to just say, do we have a blind spot in terms of the way that we're showing up for our employees? And just making sure that you create those solutions with a multiplicity of options is what I would say.
Mm-hmm. That's beautiful. Thank you, Liz Benny. And we have the last question right over here.
Hi, thanks. I'm Veronica Segovia Bedon. I work at AARP. I am an older millennial. I just turned 41 on Thursday.
Woohoo!
And I was wondering if you could share a little bit. I'm also a mom of young children. I have a 14-month-old and a 4.5-year-old. And I was wondering if you could share a little bit about how you're layering life stage in addition to age, right? So I'm 41 and have young kids. There might be some Gen Zers who I work with who have young kids. And I was happy to hear Sebastian mention some of the caregiving roles that we take on as Latinos living in multi-generational households, that we've been navigating things for our parents. So just curious how you're supporting, or if you have ideas around programs that support working parents or caregivers of anyone, not just young kids, but they might be caring for their parent or a tío, tía.
I'm laughing, looking at my wife, because we're
I wanted my husband and kids to come. He was like, no, we're not coming.
My wife is, shout out to AT&T. My wife is here representing AT&T and Samos, but we're laughing at each other because it's something that is just an ongoing struggle, right? We have two young kids, and I think empathy just comes with season of life, right? You may not understand or be able to empathize or support in the way you can until you kind of meet that change in your life. But I think a theme that we've been talking about here is just making sure that you're being intentional and you know, encouraging your team and individuals to make sure that they're comfortable sharing and being open and honest about you know, some of their struggles or some of their changes or transitions in life, so that way you can support them. Going back to the kind of CCT thing, that is part of it. That's a way to lead. And it doesn't mean by title either, right? That leading can come from anywhere in the organization, including, you know, non-traditional leadership roles. So I think when you are leading with that example, you unintentionally allow other people that ability to also show up and feel like they're comfortable sharing some of their challenges. So that's what I would say.
Thank you, Veronica.
I have to give a shameless plug because we actually have an ERG that's Working Families Network. Oh, and I'm proud of that one, because when you think about, like, we've got Women on the Move, we've got Adelante, we've got all these different groups, but that one in particular really strikes home for me, because as a mom of three and understanding the dynamics of, you know, returning to the office, or what does that look like versus, you know, leaves changing or policies and benefits changing, like there's a lot of dynamics there. So for one, I'm proud that we have an ERG that's dedicated to working families like that, that covers a variety of topics. But also just making sure that even some of our mentorship programs, you know, hopefully we're getting to a place where, from a technology and other standpoint, you know, we have affinity connections where we could say, I want a mentor that's recently returned from, you know, parental leave, or all of these different parameters. And I think that's us getting very intentional that the needs of showing up for our employees continue to evolve. So those are the kinds of things that hopefully organizations are taking into account in terms of not only caregiving for, you know, a variety of different situations, but really just making sure that overall wellness, that we're thinking about the whole employee and, you know, what it means to support them in any way throughout the journey. So, you know, again, that's one that I'm personally proud of, but I love that we have a multiplicity of ERGs that essentially lean into exactly all of the Latino factors that I can personally relate to or that I needed at some point in time. So, you know, we're maturing in that way, which is really awesome.
Thank you so much, Veronica. And thank you to our panelists, Sebastian, Kristen, and Jose Easy. If you haven't yet connected with them on LinkedIn, please do so right now. And even within the Acer app for this event, you can look down at the toolbar. There's a button that says Community, and you can send messages, meet up for a cafecito, ask for some advice so that you don't have to recreate the wheel when you are beginning the conversations of these intentional programs for intergenerations. Sebastian, Kristen, and Jose, thank you so much for your time and energy. You were perfect.
I have this thing for group selfies. So
okay, group selfies. Hey, I'm a millennial, so I'm all about selfies.
Let's do it.
Are we getting the crowd in the background?
Yeah, we're gonna get everyone.
Okay.
Try to get everyone.
Turn the lights on.
Try to be as inclusive.
Okay, let's see. Can we do this?
Perfect.
Raise your hands. Say I said.
I said.
Thank you all.
Awesome. Gracias.
Add me on LinkedIn and I'll send you the picture.
And then.
Thank you, everyone. We're going to take a group picture and then we're going to take a networking break.
Awesome.
Thank you to our speakers and moderator. We will now take a brief networking break.
Awesome.
We look forward to seeing you back in the Mardi Gras ballroom at 11:15 sharp.
Is it still on? No.
Oh, sure. Yeah, actually.
Yeah. I didn't know you...
Yeah.
Y canto a la vida de risas y penas de momentos.